My pleasure to introduce Stefano Panzeri. So Stefano is another theoretical neuroscientist. He got his undergraduate degree in physics at the University of Turin, and then he went on to get a PhD in computational neuroscience in Trieste. And he has worked all over the world. He spent a lot of time working at the in Glasgow, subsequent University of Newcastle, University at Oxford University, et cetera, et cetera. And currently he is the director of the Center for Neuroscience and
Cognitive Systems.
Cognitive Systems, Center for Neuroscience and Cognitive Systems at the Italian Institute of Technology in Rome, Italy. And you will be talking about mathematical framework to study the contribution of neural codes to perceptual decisions, which is actually a very important topic.
Thank you very much, Jim, for the invitation, and thanks to you all for coming to the talk. And I'm aware I have a strong Italian accent, so if you don't understand what I say, either ask me to repeat or look at my hands, and they will understand. And so what I want to talk about today is about some kind of joint mathematical and neurophysiological work to try to understand how we can crack a neural code, and in particular a neural code that we or animals use for sensory discriminations. And to give an idea about what I want to talk about, first I think I can start from one statement which I think is quite controversial, and that to survive, organisms like us and other animals must be able to accurately represent information that is present in the outside world, like sensory information, and then use that representation of information to discriminate between different alternatives, and then to generate an appropriate beneficial action out of, our understanding of the external world. And the question I would like to address is a question which I think is quite important for in neuroscience, and is what's the neural code, that is the set of symbols or features of neural responses that you use to perform such perceptual discriminations. And I would like to show my work of that we did, how we can define this neural code, and then how we can crack it or determine it from experimental data. And the reason why it's important to understand what's the neural code used to perform certain function, in our case, perceptual discrimination, is that I think this is a prerequisite to understand brain functions. If you have to analyze your data, you want to know what's in the data, what feature of the neural responses that you record that are crucial for doing the function you are interested in. And if you want to construct, for example, a computational model, then you want to be able that your model is able to represent the features that are actually important for representing the information that you use to do the task. For example, if, say, spike timing is an important part of the neural code, then you want your model to be able to reproduce very precisely the times of the spike, so you cannot use the right model. And what I would like to talk in this seminar is our work that we did to try to, as I said, define the neural code and crack it, and in particular, what are the mathematical tools that could be used to define and then crack the neural code from a set of experiments. And I'll try to exemplify this kind of mathematical approach with some study that we did applying this formalism to try to determine the role of millisecond precise, millisecond scale spike timing to somatosensory perceptual discriminations in rats. So first I start describing what's the traditional definition of a sensory code, that is of the neural code used for representing sensory information. And the kind of traditional definition that many people, including me, have used is the definition of a sensory. I take this, for example, from a paper that I did in Trends in Neuroscience about 5 years ago, that based on the literature, defined the sensory code as the set of features of neural responses that carry information about the sensory stimulus. Suppose in the mathematical example that I will present, I will suppose that one presents to the animal a visual stimulus, and the animal has to discriminate the color of the visual stimulus, for example, green versus blue visual stimulus. But we can think of any kind of stimulus presentation. And this definition is nice because it can let you examine what features of the neural response, for example, the timing of some spikes of some neurons, are robustly related to the stimuli and encode the difference in the stimuli. But it has a many people have used that, but it has a disadvantage that it does not tell you if the information that it presents in this data is actually then used by the animal, for example, to discriminate those stimuli. And to try to get a handle on this, one has to consider a slightly different framework. So one does not only have to consider the stage of sensory coding, that is the transformation between sensory stimuli and neural responses, but also the readout of this information. And an ideal framework to study that is, for example, a 2-4 choice discrimination task or other kinds of perceptual discrimination task, where the animal is presented, for example, here, two alternatives. The stimulus may be either, for example, green or blue. And then it has to take an appropriate choice, for example, go left or go right in order to collect a reward. And with this task, I think it's useful because you can try to disentangle the two different pieces or different computation that are part of it. So one is the mapping of sensory stimuli into neural responses that we call sensory coding. And the other is the mapping of this neural activity that carries information about the stimuli into behavior. And we call that the information readout in the following. And historically, if we look at the neurophysiological literature, these two processes have been studied mainly separately. As I said, many people studied how information about the sensory stimuli is encoded in neural activity, but this has been done in large part without considering behavior. So for example, people either used anesthetized animals or did not ask the animal to recognize the stimuli, or they only focus on correct trials, that is on trials with correct perception. And on the other hand, also information readout in order to avoid the confounders that come from the sensory modulation of the responses has been studied mainly separately from stimulus coding. For example, in a very well established paradigm, people use stimuli, like here intermediate stimuli, that have no information for the task discrimination. For example, here with the stimulus where you cannot distinguish the color. And then they try to relate the fluctuations on your activity to the fluctuation of choice. This is what people call choice probability. And this is, of course, very important, but it has a disadvantage that only focuses on this stage, the information readout, and forgets about sensory coding. And I think that a lot of the kind of disagreements and diatribes that we have about the neural code is because we really these two stages has been studied largely separately. And as a result, I think it's unclear to many people if certain features of neural activity that carry sensory information are then actually used by the brain to perceive. And the example that I will make here about this kind of uncertainty that we have about the nature of neural code is one kind of long-standing question that has been investigated extensively by neuroscientists for about 20 years or so. And that's the question of what's the role of cortical spike times? Is it noise or is it signal? In many cases, the presentation of the stimulus elicits a temporal pattern neural responses. But then some people argue that the timing of spikes is kind of random and irrelevant as far as stimulus coding of the function of the brain is concerned. And so only the total number of spikes in a given response window matters. And this is called the spike count or the spike rate code. But on the other hand, some people argue that instead what matters, for example, for stimulus representations and for sensory discriminations is the timing of the spikes. In this cartoon, for example, we made an example where you can distinguish between the stimuli not by the number of spikes, but by when those spikes are emitted with respect to the timing of the presentation of the stimulus. And I would say that normally when I give talks, if I ask people whether they believe that spike timing are important or not, I mean, it depends on the audience, but I mean, there is never an agreement. And as I said, the reason is that we don't know. I mean, we know that in many cases spike timing are reliably related to the stimulus, but we do not know whether this is used by the brain then to produce behavior. And one example, for example, of why this may not happen is that maybe, for example, at early stages, like in the sensory periphery, or for example, in layer 4 of cortex, you may have very good timing information, but then maybe it's possible that the next stage is not, maybe because of the properties of the cortical circuit, is not biophysically sensitive enough to detect precise spike timing. So any spike timing information may be washed away as you go through the brain. Or also it's possible that some information is present, but then it's encoded in a format that is impossible to interpret for downstream systems. One example that people made is that in many cases, people report information in the latency of neural responses. Latency is the timing of the spike with respect to the presentation of the stimulus. But many people argue that although you have a lot of information in it, the next stage cannot read it out because it does not have access to the stimulus time, and so it cannot read out latencies. I mean, this is one example. But in general, I would say because of the disjoint nature of the studies of information readout and sensory coding, there is a lot of uncertainty since we don't know whether many neural codes, for example, spike timing, are actually used by the brain to solve tasks. And the question I would like to address is whether we can find some simple way to probe statistically, and then I will also discuss how this can be extended to intervention, the contribution of different neural codes to the animal's percept. And the example I will make is about spike timing, but I try to stress the kind of approach that I propose is very general. It can be applied to study many different types of neural coding. And the way I try to formalize this, to try to understand if a neural code contributes to behavior, is to identify the set of features of neural responses that both carry information about the sensory variables to be discriminated in this perceptual discrimination task, and is read out by the animal to produce a choice. And I argue that I think it's obvious, but I'll try to develop it a bit further, that only features that lie in this intersection contribute to task performance. If a neural feature, for example, spike timing or spike count or whatever you want, only carries sensory information, but it does not affect the animal's choice, then it's kind of wasted away. So this a neural code, a neural feature here would carry information, but the information would be wasted. A neural coding, instead a neural feature that is related to choice, but does not carry information about the stimulus, so a neural feature here would instead be something like, for example, a variable, neural variable that is involved in the execution, for example, of the motor command that executes the choice, but that itself does not provide the information that is needed to reach to a choice. So what we're gonna do now is to try to understand how we can identify features that belong to this intersection, that is feature that carry some sensory information then that is read out to produce an above chance task performance. So this is the feature that helped the animal to collect a reward. And I mean, given this diagram, so since we look at features at the intersection between sensory information and readout, the mathematical formula that I propose, which is very simple, I call it intersection information. Is this kind of general idea clear? Okay, thank you. And so how can we define this? And I think if we want to determining if neural features belong to this intersection, I think it's important to try to find a way that can consider both the sensory coding and the readout, so the relationship between both sensory stimuli and animal's choice with neural activity together, not in a separate way. And okay. And I mean, to try to motivate why we should look at those things together, I will try to make some example that shows that it's not enough to verify if a feature of neural responses carry both stimulus and choice information, so whether it depends both on the stimulus and choice, but one should really examine what happens when you put them together. And the reason is that you can have both, so both stimulus and choice information in neural feature, but this feature does not contribute to task performance. And when this happens is the case when the feature, the neural feature or features you consider, both carry stimulus and choice information, but the rule used to encode sensory information is incompatible with the rule used to read them out. And I will give some examples of when this happens and when this doesn't happen. And to give an example, I will just consider like two different neural features. For example, this one may be spike counts, and this one may be spike timing, but could be whatever you want. This be, for example, the firing rate of area one, and this is the firing rate of area two. And we'll first consider, and what I plot here is each dot is a neural response in a given trial, so a single trial neural response. And the green dots are trials emitted in response to the green stimulus, which is stimulus number one of the cartoon that I made before. And the blue dots are spike trains emitted in response to the blue stimulus. And in this particular case that I made, information about whether the stimulus is green or blue is encoded by the sum of these two features. If the sum of these two features has a low value, it's because the stimulus is green in most trials, whereas when you put a blue stimulus, you have a high value for these features. And here, so because of this, you can decode whether it's a green or a blue stimulus if you put a decoding boundary, so a stimulus decoding boundary, which is, along this diagonal, that would be the black line, which is a little bit invisible here. If you do that, you do almost always correctly. There are only a small number of trials that are decoded incorrectly, which are those trials. And then if, for example, the readout system is perfectly optimal for this kind of information, then this means that your decision boundary, that is the discrimination line that you use by the information readout in the brain to decide exactly coincide with the sensory boundary. In this case, all information present in your activity can be used to take a decision. So that's a case where there is a perfect intersection between sensory information and readout. But then you may have a case where this is not the case. And for example, the most extreme case would be this one, where this is, this is again the same dependence of neural responses or stimuli as this one. So always, if you have a green stimulus presented, you tend to have a neural response with a low sum of R1 plus R2, so in this quadrant. If you present instead a blue stimulus, you have a high response, so the sum of those two is quite high. And so the best way to separate those guys in terms of decoding the stimulus is this line. So the decoding boundary, the optimal decoding boundary, is this one. But say that now you have that the choice of the animal is taken based on those two neural features, but it's based on their difference. So the format used to encode information, which is the sum, is incompatible with the format which is used to take the decision. In this case, the decision boundary, so the boundary separate choice number one from choice number two, so for example, go left from go right, is orthogonal to the sensory boundary. In this case, you would have that the neural features here, R1 and R2, depend both on stimulus and choice. So they have both stimulus and choice information, but there is no intersection between the two. As a result here, if the animal made its decision just based on those two features, it would not be able to operate above chance. So this is an example that you cannot measure separately sensory and choice information, so choice probability and stimulus discrimination, but you have somehow to be able to see whether sensory information provided by the neural features you consider and choice match on the single trial. In other words, what I'm proposing is to see whether the choice of the animal follows the prediction of the stimulus that you can get through neural activity. If that happens, it means that, at least at the statistical level, neural information about the stimuli is used to influence behavior. And if one reasons this way, one can find a measure that can really tell if you have a case of intersection between sensory information and behavior, so no contribution of the neural code to task performance, from a case where all or almost all information in neural activity is used to inform behavior and help the animal to perform above chance. And this measure that I called intersection information is based on this. So, as I said, conceptually, we said that there is intersection information if the feature, essentially, intersection information carried by one or more neural feature is the amount of sensory information present in neural activity that is then used to inform choice. And the way we can compute it, I mean, very simply, mathematically, is in its simple form that I could conceive is this one. So what you do is you look at, you know which stimulus has been presented in a trial, you record a neural response, then you decode which stimulus was being presented for neural activity. This may or may not be a correct decoding. If you decode correctly, it means that this neural code is providing faithful information, and then you look at the animal choice. What you want is that if the neural code or the neural feature is used to produce behavior, then you want that when the animal, when the stimulus is decoded correctly from neural activity, then the animal does the choice correctly. So the animal makes the correct choice. So the choice that reports the stimulus that you decoded from neural activity, which is the one that was presented. And conversely, also you want that when the stimulus you decode from neural activity is the wrong one, so when the neural code is giving misleading information about the stimulus, then the animal performs an incorrect choice. So the behavior of the animal is incorrect and the animal cannot collect a reward. And if we reason this way, I think that we can define very simply an intersection information. And this operational definition is that the intersection information from a particular code is the probability that in a single trial the stimulus is decoded correctly and the animal makes the correct choice. So it's a probability that in a given trial you present the stimulus and both the animal choice reports the presence of that stimulus correctly and the neuron in that trial report the choice of the animal correctly. And I think this is very simple to compute, so it's very simple. It's a very simple way to track the correspondence between information in neural code and choice, and that's also some kind of nice mathematical properties. And two of them is that this is upper bounded both by this intersection information, the performance of the animal in terms of percent of correct behavior, and also by the information in neural activity expressed as percentage of correct decoding. When all information in the neural code is used for behavior, then the intersection information equals the information in neural activity. Okay, and one simple way to visualize this is something like this. So, what you are looking for is regions of this response space of the two features, one and two, when you have both correct stimulus decoding and correct behavior. And if you have the case where all information in the neural code is read out, So there is a perfect alignment between the computation made to discriminate the stimuli, which is this sensory boundary, this decoding boundary in black, and the decision boundary in red. Then essentially all trials, all correct behaviorally correct trials, contribute to the neural code. So if you look at the fractions of dots that you would compute with this measure, essentially it's all dots with correct behavior. And here all full dots are those that have correct behavior. If instead the two are not aligned, for example here information is carried by both variables by the sum of the two. So this is sensory information, but in this case, that in this little cartoon, we assume that only variable number one is used to produce choice and variable number two is thrown away by the information readout system that determines the animal choice. In that case, you would only be able to consider a number of trials in this measure. So this intersection information would have an intermediate value. And if you instead consider the case where sensory information is carried by the sum of the neural activity, so it is separated by this black line, whereas decision is computed based on the difference between the two features, so whether one feature is bigger than the other, then you would only consider a small number of trials in this measure, and this would equal the chance level where the choice does not depend on the information on the stimulus. So this cartoon shows that it's able to capture cases of high, intermediate, and zero intersection information. So it's a simple measure, but I think it's quite useful because it gives experimental people a very simple way to rank candidate neural codes in terms of how well they can explain the performance of the animal on a single trial. So it tells how well you can predict, how well the information carried by neural activity predicts the behavior of the animal in that trial, which is, I think, is a stronger demonstration or a stronger measure than, for example, looking at stimulus information or choice information separately. For example, one thing that many neurophysiologists do if they want to evaluate if a neural code is influenced by behavior is that they try to compute the correlation between psychometric and neurometric tuning function. What they do, for example, they have these two for choice discrimination tasks and they try to do it with different degrees of information in the stimulus. So they make the task more or less difficult. For example, here, this one would be a case where there is the two stimuli present, the blue and the green, are almost indistinguishable, for example, because you have very little contrast. In this case, the two clouds of neural activity would have very little separation. And this is the case instead, for example, of high contrast, so that the stimulus is very well visible, so the associated neural responses are also better separated. And what I'm trying to draw in this cartoon is that this measure, I think, is nice, but it has the disadvantage that only looks at the trial average similarity between the neural decoding and the animal's behavior, but it does not consider the trial-to-trial fluctuations of the two. If a neural code carries information, you want them to fluctuate in the same trial. When the neural code gives good information, the animal must do the task correctly. When the neural code gives bad information, you want the animal to fail. And for example, in this case, you may have a case with zero intersection information, so a case where these two features, R1 and R2, that we consider are not used by the animal to do the task, and that's because the decision boundary is orthogonal to the sensory boundary, so the animal does not use any of the sensory information to do the task. So this is the scheme here. So stimulus is translated into the sum of those two features, but choice reads only the difference. But in cases where choice is instead caused by another region of the brain or another set of neurons that we indicate here as B, and this set of neurons have the same tuning as this R1 plus R2, you would have that the neurometric and the psychometric tuning function coincide, but the neural features from which you compute the neurometric function are not used at all by the animal to produce the task. So that's why I think that looking at these things in the single trial is a much better test of neural codes. And I think I spoke for about half an hour. So in the next 15-20 minutes, I will try to show an application of this kind of concepts to one particular experiment where we had a perceptual discrimination task, and we wanted to try to determine the nature of the neural code. And this is a very simple task that was implemented by my collaborator Matthew Diamond and his lab in Italy. And this was a whisker-based discrimination task where the animal was put on a platform, and it could it was put presented an object, and the object could be one of three with different texture from smooth to rough, and the animal could only touch these with the whiskers, otherwise it would fall into, I mean, down from the platform, and there was no light visible to the animal, and there was no other cue. So the animal really had to do this by touching the object and determine the texture with its whiskers. And then the animal had to turn left or right to collect some juice, some water, and be rewarded. And what we did was to record neural activity from both primary and secondary somatosensory cortex, and record the spike trains with respect to touch onset. So by the time when the animal touched the object, and we recorded the spike train between the moment of touch, and we measure spike times with respect to touch time, because we evaluated the hypothesis that the timing of those spikes with respect to the touch time was the variable used by the animal to carry out the task. And then we took spike train that were recorded between this touch time and the decision time that was computed from us as the time when the animal turned decisively left or right to collect reward. And here the animals crucially did the task reasonably well, like 80-something percent correct, but they did not do the task perfectly. And this was very useful for us because we had error trials and we wanted to relate correct versus error trials at the behavioral level with correct versus error trials at the level of decoding neural activity. Is this task clear? Or okay, here, so, I mean, a lot of this work was, no, okay, I cannot start the video here. But we had a camera that worked with 1 millisecond resolution put from above, and we used light not visible to the rat. And then the first part of the analysis was to segment these whisker movements and determine touch time. I'm not going to go through this. But what I'm going to go through is our work to try to use this formalism to determine which components of neural activity were used by the animal to do the task. And as I said, we were interested here in cortical spike trains, primary and secondary somatosensory cortices. And the reason why we had both primary and secondary was that, as I said, we will investigate whether spike timing is used to encode this kind of sensory information. And some people believe that spike timing information may be used at the level of at the early level of cortical representation, for example, layer 4 of cortex. But then this is kind of washed away as you go through the cortical hierarchy. So we wanted to test whether there was a difference between primary and secondary somatosensory cortex. So the first thing that we did was to look at the information content of these spike trains. We wanted to test which features of neural activity carried the most sensory information. So we concentrated on this part, sensory coding only. And for this part, we look at only at correct trials. So only at trials where the animals did the task correctly, because these were trials where arguably, I mean, there was some good sensory information coming from sensory cortex. And what we wanted to do was to evaluate the hypothesis that the temporal placement of spikes, so the millisecond scale timing of spikes, carried some information not present in the spike rates computed as done traditionally over several tens of milliseconds. And also we wanted to see whether rate and timing, when put together, carry more information than either of the two. That is whether essentially there is some kind of multiplexing where each time scale, millisecond scale, and 10 millisecond scale carry some complementary information so that you get more information out of the two than you can get from one alone. And so the first thing was to try to extract in a very simple way some kind of informative timing features from the neuron. So I think it's very easy to compute the spike rate, you just count the spikes, but how can you take an informative timing feature out of the spike train? And there are many ways to do it, and the way we use here was to use some kind of compression algorithm to provide a timing template, which was the weight that we have to give to a spike, depending on the time where it was emitted, in order to discriminate the stimuli more efficiently. And in this diagram, so this is time zero, so the touch time where the animal touches the texture, and then this is a scale of a few tens of milliseconds where the animal is holding contact with the texture. This is about 50 milliseconds. And this is the weight we give to each spike depending when it's emitted in order to decode them. And with this formalism, a rate template where you just count the spikes would correspond to a flat template where each spike has the same weight irregarding on where it was emitted, when it was emitted. So this is an example of what I said before. So if we had the spike train like this with four spikes, and we had the timing template like this, in order to compute the spike timing variable that we use to compute information from it, we weighted the spikes with this kind of function. If we wanted to compute the rate, we just weighted the spike with the same function. And one thing that is important to bear in mind is that we use a very simple trick in order to make the timing and the rate as independent as possible. And the simple trick was that to impose that this timing template that we use to weigh the spikes, depending on their timing, had the zero mean over time. With this very simple thing, if it has zero mean, a distribution of spike timing to different stimuli will always be centered around zero. So, I mean, the template, this means that irregarding of the number of spikes, this will always be centered around zero. And so rate and timing defined in this way are essentially, under the proper conditions, statistically independent. So this timing signal does not include the rate information. It's kind of orthogonal to it. And this is useful for a number of reasons, because it gives us a better chance to dissociate the role of rate from the role of timing. If you look at the data, there were essentially was almost zero correlation between rate and timing. I mean, there was some, but it was really, really small. And so this was what we used. And to give like a more concrete example of how these rate and timing templates look like and how these neurons encode information, I'll give you an example of one neuron. And here we had three textures. Two were associated with go left, and one was associated with go right in terms of reward. I think that this was associated with right, and those two were associated with left. And I mean, this is the raster, so single trials of all the neurons, where only neurons with, or the trials with one, at least one spike were plotted for simplicity. This is maybe a little difficult to look at. So, but if you look now at the trial average of those lines, which is the instantaneous firing rate, you see that, for example, when you presented an object with this texture, so the 4 millimeters object, you had a peak of neural activity at 10 milliseconds post-stimulus. So those are neurons with very short latency. But when you presented a smooth stimulus, or a stimulus with no pattern, you had this kind of profile of neural responses post-touch. So you had the peak at about 17 milliseconds. And if you look at the spike rate, which is the integral of those curves over time, you see that those are more or less the same. So you cannot distinguish very well the red stimulus, so the 4 millimeter stimulus, from the blue stimulus, the smooth stimulus. just counting the spikes. This is the average across trials. But you can discriminate them well if you weight them with this template. So if you give a positive weight to spikes emitted here and the negative weight to spikes emitted here, you will get something like this, a very clear distinction between the responses emitted here and the responses emitted here. So this is just one example, but gives you an idea of the trend that we'll find in the data, that there are very fine object-specific or texture-specific differences in the timing of the neurons on the millisecond scale. And if you look at the time differences of the neurons, you can discriminate the sensory objects better than if you count the spikes.
So how do you find the template? So you have a constraint and the integral is
zero? Constraint literally is zero, and then
you optimize for discrimination?
Yeah, we use the principal component procedure. We only took three principal components and threw away all the rest. And then we sum the principal components in an optimal way to get the maximal stimulus decoding for that neuron in a cross-validated way. So it's a way to extract, it's a dimensionality reduction that preserves as much information as we can about the stimuli. But it's also a lower bound on the information that you can extract from timing, whereas the one from rates is not a lower bound because rate is easily defined. So also the conclusion I'm going to present are kind of conservative with respect to this. So then we did this game systematically for all the single neurons and multi-unit activity and whatever you want. And here we plot stuff using, the results using an information measure. Visual information is a measure of how well you can discriminate neural responses stimuli from the single type observation neural responses. But you can think of this also as a kind of percent correct above chance. So zero will be chance, and this will be percent correct. And if you look, this is primary somatosensory neurons, and this is secondary somatosensory neurons. We can just focus on these. And what we have is that rate carries information, timing carries more information. So both are important. And if you put the two together, you get an amount of information which is approximately the sum of the two. So what this means is that, timing seems to contribute to sensory coding a little bit more than rate in general, and that both carry information in a complementary way, because when you put them together, you get an information which is about the sum of the two. So this suggests that both rate and timing carry information, timing carries more, but also that information is multiplex. So each time scale, this is millisecond scale timing, this is a tens of millisecond ray, carry information about the stimuli that complements that of the other variable. So in terms of sensory coding, timing carries information and rate carries information. And this is multiplexed in time. And this is really like millisecond scale information. This is examples of there were about 600 neurons in this analysis. And we found that if you cluster all the shapes of these templates for each neuron with the clustering algorithms with about 12 classes, you can cluster them. And if you use the template of this cluster, the optimal template of the neuron, you don't lose any information. So there is a small amount of sensory of neurons. And depending on the shape here, you can also understand which computation the neuron would have to do in order to decode this information. For example, this is a comparison. This compares whether the stimulus has an early or a late response, and so on. But this is really millisecond scale variations of neural activity that we are looking at. So after determining that spike timing carries sensory information, now we ask about the readout. So which variables of neural activity of the same neurons influence choice? So whether they can predict whether the animal will go left or right. And of course, since you have error trials, there is some degree of dissociation between stimulus and choice. So it is possible that variables carry information but do not determine choice. So we did the same analysis, now including also error trials. And I will only present now results from primary somatosensory cortex because results for secondary somatosensory cortex are the same. So we have again, as for sensory information, that timing had more choice information, so determined choice better than rate. And when you put the two together, you had that you could predict choice much better than either of those individually. And again, the prediction you afford from both was like the sum of the two, which is a similar conclusion. So for choice that you get from stimulus, so both rate and timing influence choice in a complementary kind of multiplex way. So in terms of information readout, you would think that both timing and rate are important, and timing is more important. And again, as I said, this is good because this shows that both rate and timing belong to the sensory information domain and also to the readout domain. But what we want to ensure is that they belong to their intersection, so that the information about the sensory stimuli present in these features of neural activity is used by the animal to do the task above chance. And to do that, we use this measure that I introduced before that I called intersection information that we use to rank the neural codes. And this measure is, again, the fraction of trials where the neurons, the feature of neurons that you consider carry correct sensory information, so you can predict the stimulus correctly for neural activity, and the animal does the task right. So you can see, and if you start track the chance level from this measure, you can interpret this measure as the probability that the animal does the task better than chance when the considered neural code, so the feature of neural activity consider, is providing correct information. So in this case, for example, you see that whenever the average neuron in our data set provided correct information about the stimulus, you had about 2% higher than chance probability, higher than normal probability that the animal did the task correctly. If the sensory stimulus decoded by timing was correct, so if the timing was giving faithful sensory information, then the animal had an about 5% probability of above normal of doing the task correctly. So this is like normal level of performance, average level. And if you instead had both of them together giving good information, so both rate and timing predicted the stimulus correctly, then you would have 6% higher than normal probability of doing the task correctly. So again, the conclusion here in this case is that both variables that carry sensory information and influence choice, rate and timing, belong to this intersection. So they're used by the animal to increase its probability of, to do the task above chance. And again, there is some multiplexing. So information in tens of millisecond rays and 1 millisecond scale timing seems to be complementarily combined in order to perform the task. So in this case, the analysis of both sensory information and choice would have given, I would say, the correct results in terms of inferring whether rate and timing contribute to behavior. But as I said, this test is more important because you can rule out a number of confounders. And as an additional test that we did to try to see whether timing was more important than rate, we did another kind of complementary but even simpler analysis. So we took all the trials where decoding rate would tell the animal to go, for example, left, and decoding timing would tell the animal to go to the other direction. So we call them contradictory trials. So you can have, for example, in these contradictory trials, rate tends to go left and timing to go right, or the other way around, rate tends to go right and timing tends to go left. So what you can do with these trials is then to measure the choice of the animal and see whether the choice of the animal sides more with timing or sides more with rate. And if you do this analysis, that you see that in 60% of trials, choice of the animal sides with the information in timing, and in 40% only sides with rate. which is again compatible with the idea that timing is more important in this task, millisecond timing, than spike rate. And I think it kind of also makes sense to me in terms of optimal coding, because if you have two sources of information, and when they contradict each other, the best way that you have is to listen to the source of information, which is on average more correct. And that's what the animal seems to do. The source of information that has more sensory information is timing. And when there is a contradiction, the animal seems to side with the information in timing, that is with the source of information that is on average more trustable, which I think kind of makes sense. So it confirms the finding that we had with other analysis. And to conclude the talk, I think I'm approaching the timing that I would like to tell something that we haven't finished, but we are trying to do, and is try to move from a purely statistical approach where we determine the features of neural activity that are likely to carry sensory information that is used for behavior, so to do the task from a statistical point of view, that is recording neural activity and analyzing it with this formalism, for example, to determine the spike timing is important and so on, to try to then probe these hypotheses about the neural coding that are only hypotheses because they are determined at the statistical level with causal intervention. And the idea is that if you do an experiment with recording neural activity and you form an hypothesis, for example, the millisecond timing of this neuron in this way and cause the stimulus and so on, then you if you have a good way, for example, with pattern light optogenetics where you can simulate cells with good spatial and temporal resolution, then you can do an experiment where you sometimes interleave trials where you don't have a sensory stimulus, but you just induce neural activity in the absence of the stimulus. And what you can do, you can use this sensory information study that you did before at the statistical level in order to decode the neural activity, decode the stimulus that would correspond to the neural activity that you are inducing with intervention, for example, with optogenetics. We call this intersection guided intervention. And then you can reward, if you have a good online algorithm, the animal with the choice that corresponds to the stimulus that would have been decoded from the sensory information dictionary correctly. And then you can see whether the animal reports that stimulus or the other one. And if the animal reports the stimulus that you would decode from neural activity with the sensory dictionary that you form with this intersection formalism, then you have a proof that the animal uses information carried by these neural features to perform the task. So all statistical analyses are prone to the possible artifact that the choice information you have in the data and also the intersection information are not the real cause of the perception, but are just, for example, an efference copy of it. So this might correlate the true decision, but might not be the true cause. But if you instead fix this neural activity, so if you provoke the neural activity in this way, you break up the correlation of this neural activity with all other brain variables because you choose it. And therefore, any kind of task performance that you have above chance must be due to the sensory information you inject directly in these neurons by reproducing those patterns that you observe during natural sensation. So if you do that, you have a natural formalism to essentially be able to form an hypothesis about the neural code based on statistical considerations, and then to immediately test it with the causal experiments. So to determine the whether the neural code really causes behavior. Okay, so to conclude and to summarize, I apologize, this was not very clear, but in this work we develop what we hope to be a useful statistical formalism to quantify which feature neural activity carry sensory information that is used to perform perceptual discrimination, and even to rank possible neural codes in terms of how much they are useful to the task in terms of the information they carry. And also one nice feature of this formalism that is relatively easily transformed into an interventional formalism that can be used to probe causally the hypotheses that are generated by the statistical analysis of neural activity, and that a first application of these concepts to somatosensory coding showed that timing information, which is often thought not to be used by the brain to perform tasks, is actually quite important to, I mean, at least for perceiving texture with whiskers. And it's so important that timing seems to be the dominant neural coding into this task. Okay, and before I conclude, I thank you for your attention, and I thank my collaborators in this study that were, for the experiment, Matthew Diamond and this postdoc Zhu Yanfang, and for data analysis, my postdoc Human Safai that is now at Harvard, and then for the conceptual framework to link statistical analysis to optogenetics, I work with Tommaso Fellin, Peter Latham at UCL, and Chris Harvey at Harvard Medical School. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thinking of your rate model as a sort of describing a 1D space of kernels, and your timing model describing sort of n minus one parameter space of kernels, raises the possibility for me that the improved performance of the timing theory is due to model complexity. Is there anything you did to control for overfitting?
We fitted the model on training data, and then we decoded test data. And in addition to that, we use other methods when you compute the information to remove any spurious effect that could be left because of finite sampling. So we use finite sampling correction to remove any bias. And so I think the result that we have are sufficiently cross-validated. And also the number of parameters the dimensionality of the code was the same both for the rate and for the timing code.
How'd you increase the dimensionality of the rate code? It just seemed like you only changed one.
You had one number for both. So the rate code is one number, 1, 2, 3, 0 spikes, whatever. And the timing score is also one number.
But that curve was so complex because it's learned from the data. And
it's learned from the data in a cross-validated way.
Okay, I see.
Yeah. But still, it's also one-dimensional. Which I think is useful, especially when you compute information quantities. If you use multidimensional representations, then you are more, since the measure is nonlinear, you may have a bias because of that, which tends to explode if you put many variables. So that's one of the reasons why, also for the timing code, we prefer to have a low dimensional representation that probably throws away some information, but still should be able not to lead to major artifacts in the calculation.
So the time interval you use for the rate model, you was basically the same as the size of the kernel you get optimally? Or?
Yes, it was the same. Yeah, and we varied this between 20 and 50 milliseconds. 50 milliseconds was usually the end of the touch, and 20 was a shorter duration, and the results were kind of consistent.
So you raised this issue earlier of how to read out certain timing codes. You would need to have access to the zero time point. And that seems to be true for these kernels also. So I'm curious if you have a sense of what experimentally the evidence is that the readout has access to this and what forms.
It's a good question. I don't have any slides here. But so the first comment is that these neurons very rarely fired more than one spike per trial. So this code here was really a latency code.
Yeah.
So what we measure here was the timing of one spike with respect to touch time. And so you can argue that whatever readout system doesn't know when touch is applied, and so cannot read out this information. So, but I have two lines of evidence against this. Is one, that timing correlates with behavior. So it seems that the animal has a way to do that. And second is that in this session we had a few tetrods, two or three tetrods, I don't remember, And so we had about 10 neurons simultaneously recorded. And about one or two of those neurons appeared to respond, not in all trials, but in most trials, in a texture-independent way with a very short latency. And so you can take those neurons as a touch time neurons. And when we had those neurons in the session, we tried to do the same analysis, but referring, so using as a touch time the one estimated for neural activity rather than from, I mean, the videos. And that we had still a good spike timing information, not as good as this, but relatively close, I don't know, like 70% optimal. So our argument is that if we had a larger population and a sufficient number of these touch time neurons, we would be able to do these relatively, I mean, optimally. Right. And we also had the paper in auditory cortex where we found again these sound onset neurons, and if we decoded sound selective neurons, spike timing, referring to the onset time, we would decode like 90% of the information.
So actually, the reason I asked was not so much to raise sort of a concern, but rather to wonder about an opportunity. Because if now you've identified a signal that is a reference point for a timing code,
yes,
it seems like you might be able to artificially,
yes,
inject such a signal, and then you would have a very specific prediction,
yes,
about the errors that would be made,
yes,
because you would shift.
Yes,
yeah, so
I agree with that. I thought about that. I agree with you. Yes.
Yeah.
And the prediction would be that it's the relative timing of those two signals that correlates to the animal's perception.
Right, because you've estimated the temporal,
yeah,
kernels, you would be very precise about exactly what would happen for,
yes,
different shifts in that signal.
So in this experiment, you would manipulate independently the two and see that only their difference matters.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm. The second side of this, which is behavioral outcome.
Yeah.
Really makes it look like sort of a two-layer or two-stage process. There's sensory and,
yes,
sensory and behavior. But in a brain system like the visual system, there are multiple,
yes,
stages of processing. Is,
yeah,
it possible to use later stages of the neural pathway as your outcome measure to see which,
yes,
features in an earlier stage,
yes,
are used to be read out,
yes,
in that later stage? Is,
yes,
that, adapt this to that?
Yes, one can do that. So, I mean, you can imagine that here you have, say this is area one and this is area two. So
exactly.
You can try to see whether the information in area one influences the information in area two. You can repeat the same analysis. And in fact, in this paper that is under revision in Neuron at the moment, we argued that in this way you have a practical way to measure if, for example, if you have a chain of these measurements from different areas, if sensory information in area say three comes from the sensory information say in area one, in that case you would see that the prediction of the stimulus from area one fluctuates together coherently with the one in area three. So. It's a way to, I mean, so essentially to measure like stimulus-specific functional connectivity, if you adapt the measure in a sufficient way.
So you apply the fMRI data, do you think?
I don't know. Probably, yes. If you have a good decoding from one area, you could try to do that. Yeah. Yeah.